Thanks for coming to CentralTrak. Today we welcome two members of the four-person collective of Postcommodity. They've had this video installation up for the last 6 weeks, I think, and today's the last day, so I'm glad you guys are here to see it. And I'm just gonna, Nathan Young and Kade Twist are with us today. And I'll let them just go there. Thank you.
First of all, I'd like to thank the University of Texas at Dallas and CentralTrak and I for being such really generous, gracious hosts and providing a space for us and allowing us to get to know Dallas, get to know some of the people and the environment, and we're looking forward to coming back as soon as we can and really using this as a residency rather than just a site visit. But yeah, it was really nice to have a chance to do a site visit, and y'all have a beautiful facility here. As I'd mentioned, we're Postcommodity, and we're a transdisciplinary indigenous collective. There's four members, Cristobal Martinez, Raven Chacon, myself, and Kade Twist, and Nathan Young. And did you want to talk a little bit about yourself, a little bio? Or?
Well, no, I even do Kade's bios in these too, so.
I can do my bio.
Go ahead.
Afterward.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm really happy to be here. This is a really, really cool space, and we've really enjoyed our time here. Like I said, my name is Nathan Young. Currently, I live in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I'm an Oklahoma Indian. I grew up in Oklahoma. I'm a member of the Pawnee, Kiowa, Delaware tribes. Kade and I are actually two of the oldest members of Postcommodity. We kind of try to get away with the idea of founders, but the fact of the matter is, and Kade and I basically kind of started this idea while we were still students at the University of Oklahoma. We were taking classes with Edgar Heap of Birds and a lot of Native American Studies classes and art history classes together. So, I just wanted to mention that, we were kind of, it's our baby. Yeah, so I live in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I'm a filmmaker by vocation. All of us in Postcommodity were professional artists, full-time artists. I primarily work outside when I'm not doing my own practice work. Working Postcommodity, I work in American Indian health and social justice issues. So I create documentaries, PSAs, other media for tribes in Oklahoma. I'm very fortunate in a sense that Postcommodity, we view it as an indigenous lens. Postcommodity is a collective in a sense. We would never do a group show. We're not a collective that exists to support a practice that exists to create a space to have group shows or anything like that. We create work that is a singular lens, that's an indigenous lens. So that's very important to state. I'll just take a minute.
And I'm Kade Twist, Cherokee. My roots are in Northeast Oklahoma, where Nathan's are, but I was raised in Bakersfield, California. I'm a writer, public policy analyst, or public affairs professional. That's what I do for, to make a living. But I'm also a full-time artist. I guess I have two jobs. I got into the arts through writing, and it's still a really important part of my working process. I usually start with metaphors in narrative form or poetic form, and then try to translate them into a visual form. But I'm really fortunate to be a part of what Postcommodity has become. It's been interesting. It's been a very interesting experience. One of the reasons why we formed Postcommodity, there's a lot of reasons, but a few that come to mind real quick are There's no money in conceptual art, or there's no money in installation art unless you're a blue chip artist, and there are just a handful of those, two handfuls of those that have gallery representation, so forth and so forth. The rest of us have relationships, you know, with institutions, and work with institutions, and do exhibitions, and as you all know, there's those artist fees are tiny, and the budgets are meager, and so there was, it was kind of a revolt against the art world system. You know, it's a lot more practical and pragmatic and more efficient to work as a collective. We can create a factor of 4 to 1 on our output, and or 1 to 4, I should say. So it's really, it's about creating efficiencies. It's about taking small budgets and getting 4 times as much out of them as an individual artist would. It also is a way of subverting the idea of the individual, the ego, that Western notion of this artist, this genius, this single person that disappears in a studio and comes out of work, because in reality we all know that when you're doing large scale installation work, whether you're, regardless if you're a collective or an individual, it's a collaborative process. You're working with teams of people to produce the work. I don't know anybody who is working internationally in this field that disappears into a studio and comes out with a $100,000 budget work. You know, it just doesn't happen that way. There's too many moving pieces. So we're just essentially acknowledging that art making in the context that we work is a collaborative process. And we're just putting that straight out, right out front, that there is no individual ego. This is a collaborative process. We all work collaboratively from the R&D phase to design phase to implementation and installation phase. So we're really hands-on, and we really take advantage of that idea of increasing the capacity of the artist from one set of eyes, one set of ears, to having 4 sets of eyes, 4 sets of ears. I think the work has the capacity of more nuance, more complex, better position, and I think that's something that is very, very important to consider, is positioning your work as artists, particularly as indigenous artists, where there are expectations for you know, American Indian artists or indigenous artists to be object-based, to primarily make work for an Indian art market, to contribute to a discourse that is us versus them, or it's a trauma, or it's reacting to stereotypes, or what have you. So we're able to sidestep a lot of that, and I think that's an important part of our practice.
Yeah, I really don't think it could be stressed enough how important it was to us as indigenous artists to kind of try to break away from the mold as the artist as activist, working in these dichotomies that are focused on history, with like the opportunity to work on and think about the ideas of the future, things like that. We really felt that there wasn't a lot of that work happening, and it's a very small world as far as American Indian Indigenous artists go, and so the opportunity to really find a community of people to work with that really felt a need to really sidestep these dialogues and to create and really kind of confuse, complicate, and even broaden the notion of what it means to be an American Indian, what American Indian art looks like, what American Indian experience is, was really kind of one of the primary impetus for us to start the collective.
And there's something about each of us as individuals. I mean, in our own practices individually, we have there's a couple things that bring us together. One is our appreciation for music, for experimental music, for sound, for sound art. You know, if you look at the history of art, contemporary art, modern art, you go to MoMA in New York, you go from the the top four down or the bottom four up. What you notice is the history of the art world is largely deaf, and sound is usually an afterthought. And when it is staged as, you know, sound art and given an appropriate stage, it's usually neutered, and it's usually relocated in the back end of group shows. Or if it is a solo show of a sound artist, it's usually in an inferior space, and it's not provided with the opportunity to really have the impact that the medium should. So all of us have that commitment to, as well as many other artists are working today, working with sound, of changing that history, of advocating within the art room to provide a platform for sound and a legitimacy of sound as a medium that can not only add layers of content to existing pieces, but in their own right, you know, function as a very important sculptural former medium. And we're all musicians. Some of us are composers. I'm not a composer. I'm probably the worst musician out of the group, too. But, and I might have been playing music longer than anyone else, too, because I'm like one of the oldest dudes. But we are, I just don't get better with it. But yeah, we're all committed to, you know, we've all been in bands. We grew up making music, gigging, touring, you know, stuff like that. So that's something that brings us all together is we love our what the ears are capable of processing. And we want to make sure that other people acknowledge that.
I've got to tell you guys about people who are very important to starting Postcommodity. First of all, there's a member of Postcommodity named Stephen Yazzie. He's a very successful painter, lives in Phoenix, Arizona. He was one of the original members of Postcommodity. He's very important to, you know, us, you know, be able to really, you know, we all did the work together. So we started, you know, really Postcommodity in its like youngest stage was 2006, 2007. And we really didn't start creating what we consider like our mature phase of work till about 2009. And at the time we were having, so the collective consisted of Kade and I, Stephen Yazzie, and then we brought in Raven Chacon. And Raven Chacon is a Navajo composer. I met him through experimental noise communities, playing, he would be touring, coming through Oklahoma. But people were always like, you need to meet this guy, you need to meet this guy, because it's a small community. Finally, we did meet, and it was like, you know, serious connection, you know, with this was a person. It's one thing, it's like Postcommodity, it's difficult to find a lot of people. Not a lot of people in our community are interested in this type of work. Raven had attended Cal Arts and was doing really great things with composition, experimental composition, things like that, and so it was really exciting to have him come on. So 2009, this piece is called Do You Remember When? It's like I said, it was myself, Kade, and Stephen, and Raven. We were invited to participate, to install this work at the university, or Arizona State University, at the Ceramics Research Institute during a sustainability conference. The sustainability conference didn't feel that they had a an indigenous voice in all of their programming. So there was an idea for this space to bring in indigenous artists. And something we'll kind of talk about in a lot, I guess, or for a little while, is that sometimes with, say, if, you know, if you're a hyphenated artist, if you're, say, a black artist or you know, queer or whatever, you know, there are always these hyphenated things. Well, you know, and it feels like there's this glass ceiling or there's the ghetto of American Indian art, things like that. So for instance, this space right here, this is Do You Remember When? This work had work laid on top of it twice. So another artist came inside, another artist came into the space, created work on top of our work, and another artist created work on top of that work. So just to give you an idea, that's a very unconventional thing to do to any type of Western artist. It would probably not be acceptable. American artists oftentimes have to accept those kinds of ideas, move forward. Luckily for us, we were actually getting, you know, kind of gaining steam, or the collective was really coming together. You know, just to give you some context as to, you know, the situation. So there was this conference, but first of all, I've been talking about Mel Chin. I had the opportunity to see Mel Chin speak earlier this year, and I know Kade's also had studio visits and also seen him speak and met with him and knows him. And Mel Chin said, well, as a conceptual artist, you come up with an idea that's so crazy that you know somebody will say no. And then when they quit saying no, then you have to do it and give you the money, and that's the word. So with this piece, you know, obviously this is the Ceramics Research Center, we wanted to cut a hole from the floor. And the idea was is to expose the earth and to remind people of the original stewards of the land, and how in the conceptual feedback loop of basically the Western Judeo-scientific worldview, this green and sustainability conference. So you had a technology or a worldview that had created scarcity, that had created a crisis, and was using the same scientific methods to solve this crisis. We feel that there was a gap missing in that knowledge, and it was the knowledge of people who had lived in this place, in Phoenix, Arizona, possibly the most unsustainable place in America. People who lived there for a long time. So we were able to, first of all, cut a hole out of the floor, which was quite a feat in itself, and people just basically laughed at us. We're not the first artists to cut a hole in the floor of any museum or building. But in Arizona, we were kind of met with a lot of derision and just kind of people didn't think it was possible. Thanks to kind of our extra-disciplinary skill sets, we were able to secure, you know, the permission to cut a hole out of the floor. We also worked with a Peeposh Indian singer, learned a Peeposh song. They were the original stewards of the land. So when you see this system that we've created here, there's a buried speaker in the middle of that in the ground that emits this Peeposh Indian song. The song goes into this microphone, goes back out into the rafters, this other system, comes back to this slab. Now the slab, when we cut it out, there were flaws in just the concrete. And so we had a piece of it fall apart. And really we just saw that as an opportunity to really get inside there without having to be destructive. So we placed a piezo microphone inside the plinth, or the slab. We, as a collective, we view this plinth as a monument or a trophy. I think that actually, you know, pieces of it, we use the coordinates, the actual coordinates of the space to name it. But so we've created a very, very large complex system here where the plinth is activated by this guitar, the guitar speaker on the plinth, or guitar amp on the plinth that shakes and rumbles the slab that creates another feedback loop that goes out throughout the system. As you walk through the system, or through the space, you'll hear the feet of people. You'll hear the drone of the slab, this bass drone coming out. And so, in a sense, it's interactive is really kind of a problematic word in a sense, but the space is alive, you know. And we have another iteration of this piece, and we'll talk more about that. But here's a video of what it sounded like. So in 2012, we were invited by the Sydney Biennale to restage New York Never Win. And it's been really interesting for us as artists to kind of go through, you know, to just experience the differences. First of all, we're laughed at whenever we wanted to cut the floor out of the Arizona State University. When we were asked in Sydney to come and do this, we cut the floor out of one of it's basically their Met, you know, the Museum of New South Wales. And we were asked, you know, I mean, it was a matter of seconds, and they said yes. So things changed. And the piece changed. We were working in Australia, a couple of different projects that year. And we found ourselves in a contested space. The piece necessarily didn't become about, it wasn't necessarily about sustainability and gaps in indigenous knowledge. We found that this was a contested space as far as Aboriginal people were concerned, because the people who participated in this for us, there was a conflict between the original inhabitants and the people who were the inhabitants for the last 200 years. So we found ourselves in this space and really a really interesting situation, and really learning a lot about you know, Aboriginal experience. But the piece changed, and now really kind of the kind of thing that that I think about, and it comes up is now how does this piece work if there's a third iteration? You know, it's the first time, you know, it's this like a destructive brutalist act. The second time is an imitation, and the third time, what kind of imitation is that, and what does it mean? Are we losing, you know, does it have its teeth still, and things like that?
This is a piece that was part of an exhibition that we were commissioned to develop for the 400th anniversary of Santa Fe in 2010. And this particular piece is called My Brothers in Water. And it's one of three pieces we created for the exhibition. And this is what it looked like. This is at the Museum of Contemporary Native Arts, which is a very small museum, but for the history of contemporary Indian art, it's a very important space, very sacred space. They've mounted a lot of really important shows there, and have highlighted some of the contemporary Indian masters and some of the modern masters as well. This piece is actually in the Allen Hauser Sculpture Garden behind the museum. So this piece, you know, Allen Hauser, as you probably know, was a late modernist sculptor, really fluid, beautiful lines. But represents probably two generations before us of Indian artists. So you immediately get to see the evolution of materials and tactics and content from his time to our time. But one of the challenges with you know, going into a space, again, another contested space, right? Santa Fe, which is home to the Pueblo Revolt in the 1680s. But you know, Spanish occupation before then, and then Spanish reoccupation that led to larger colonization of the area. But what we use this as a test for ourselves, I think, as a collective, to how can we respond to this complex area that is so everybody. It's in the contemporary consciousness of people as being a kind of a yuppie tourist place, or a place where new agey people go to discover themselves, or, you know, buy Indian stuff, you know, commodify culture, that sort of thing. How do we work in that environment, in that loaded territory, and acknowledge the history of the place, but acknowledge the contemporary reality of the place, which isn't that. The Indian market itself is, as soon as you get out of Santa Fe, it becomes more and more meaningless. When you get towards the Pueblos, and you just work yourself away from Santa Fe in any direction. You know, once you get 50 miles away, nobody cares about the Indian art market anymore. You know, and Indian commercial art, or any of those problematics of, that we have to deal with as Indian artists. So there's that. Then there's the idea of, because the Indian market, which I don't know if you all know the herd of Indian market, but about 100,000 people come into Santa Fe the third weekend of August every year to engage contemporary commercial Indian art, object-based art, and a lot of East Coast people come in so they can shake hands with the artist, buy the work from them cheaper than they can get from the gallery, then go back home and tell stories about the Indian they met and the art they bought. But so that's the backdrop. We were asked to also respond to that, which we didn't. We just don't want to respond to that. That's not our art practice. But to step outside of that binary of us versus them, which is a core goal of Postcommodity, is to take contemporary Indian discourse outside of that binary. Because, you know, when you look at the reality of who we are, where we live, we're all interconnected, first of all. So you can't separate one from the other in this day and age. It's just not possible. It's that is an act of theoretical futility to do so. The other thing is, you know, we're part of a new globalism, right? And, you know, this colonizing force is all of us that comprise America. You know, none of us are innocent. We all have blood on our hands. We're all problematic in our support of consumerism and globalism and trade policy and the hegemonic politics of America that drives those sorts of things. So we all vote and support those things, consciously or unconsciously, whether we do it as activists or we do it passively, we're still engaged in the process. So we wanted to move beyond, you know, what people might think of colonization and develop a visual, use a like a semiotic vehicle for the hemisphere and for that region that really connects people together. You know, New Mexico is a land of people who hunt. It's been that way since it was just Indian people, and it's been that way when it was Spanish and Indian people, and it's that way today, now that it's multicultural and Indian people. So that mule deer is an important source of sustenance. It's also an important spiritual mediator for Indian people. But it's also an important spiritual leader of, mediator of survivance for all the people on land, because we all came from the mule deer in that region. You know, our survival as peoples living in New Mexico wouldn't be there without the mule deer. So we wanted to use that as a as our primary iconography. And so what we have here is a taxidermy mule deer that is hung as if, you know, you hang it to bleed out before you butcher. And but what you have is the blood from that deer, which was in a like a camel bladder, and dripping about every 15 seconds. One big fat drop of blood would come out. And that blood was, of course, fake. You know, it wasn't deer blood. There was a tiny bit of blood, there was a lot of stage blood, there was a lot of water, and there was a tiny bit of food coloring, and some other things, just to make it congeal, coagulate, look real, you know, do all those things, but still be manageable. And that fell and dripped onto a Pueblo drum. Now this Pueblo drum was reappropriated, or repatriated, I should say, from the commercial environment to the, you know, Indian environment, because we bought that at that gift store at the Albuquerque airport. There was a bunch of t-shirts sitting on top of it. And so we bought it and we repatriated that thing and used it in peace. There's a piezo microphone or contact mic that is embedded in that drum so that every 15 seconds that drop of blood hits the top of the drum and you hear this boom, you know, and it was a boom you could hear, you know, a block or two away. And so that piece was recording the process of New Mexico and the history and the process of time itself. You could say it's a timepiece. You could say it documents a history of before there were people on the land, there was just the animal people. From the animal people, the blood drips out, hits the drum, and becomes the people who live in the area, you know, and inhabited the what's the present world, and, you know, scattered about. So it's a way of documenting that. It's also, you know, it can be seen as a sundial. but it was probably the purest semiotic vehicle we thought we could create that spoke to the land, spoke to the people, spoke to the shared interests of humanity that are there on that land, regardless of how contested that space is. So we can share a little bit of more documentation of the piece. You might not be able to hear the bass, you know, through these speakers. It'll be interesting because it's kind of lower frequency sound. And again, all of this is taking place in the sculpture garden. And while Indian market is going on. You know, the interesting thing, not to like riff on Indian market or nothing, but most art fairs, Frieze or whatever, there are a lot of installation-based work that gets exhibited there. There's a lot of non-object-based work that's bought and sold at these art fairs. But interestingly enough, at the Indian market, there's no space for non-object-based work. It's not represented. There's no place to show it. And there are so many artists that are out there in the booths that do make that kind of work that just don't get an opportunity to connect with the masses in that environment like you would at a larger international contemporary art fair. They just totally wipe that potential out. You know, there's no, there aren't parallel exhibitions of work, group shows, things like that. You have the booths, like a mile of booths.
One thing too, you know, that's really kind of, I think it's important to kind of share is that this piece is, this idea of blood dripping on this drum. Actually, you know, the idea comes from, you know, modern composition and early electronic music and experimental music, people, Smithsonian folkways, but, you know, these early electronic labels were, there were you know, great pressing records, you know, experimental work, you know, using water, things like that. So, this is very important to, you know, our background as composers and artists, and that those ideas very much exist in this piece. It's about a lot of things, but as far as our process goes, oftentimes, you know, it might be for somewhere where you're not expecting at all whatsoever. But that kind of leads into this next piece.
Do you want to go ahead? This is if history moves at the speed of its weapons, then the shape of the arrow is changing. And it's essentially well, it's a gold room. It's painted with gold paint. And it's a 8-channel sound installation. What this is doing is it's creating a sonic ambush of sorts. It's based on the physics modeling of the Pueblo Revolt era weapons, you know. So we did the physics modeling and bow and arrow, the atlatl, the sling and rock, and war club. And it sonifies an infinite number of ambush scenarios within the gallery space. Now, to sonify this piece created a pretty complex algorithm and a computer language called Max MSP. Nothing special about that, but what happened was, I mean, we in terms of doing the physics modeling, we essentially applied, you know, the same technique that a rocket scientist would apply to rockets. We looked at velocity, we looked at trajectory, we looked at altitude, we looked at barometric pressure, we looked at impact energy, you know, all of these things to do a full ballistics analysis, but also make it as site-specific as possible to the gallery environment. So it took into consideration the altitude of the gallery, the barometric pressure of the gallery, all of those things. And this was like an 18-page math equation for each instrument to create those algorithms to sonify those instruments or those weapons. So you have a sine tone that represents like a bow and arrow, a square tone that represents the atlatl, a triangle tone that represents the sling and rock, and like a sawtooth tone that represents a war club, you know. So the basic, you know, physical sounds that make up all the sounds we hear, we utilize those pure tones and spatialize them across the room. So they would travel, you know, from one point to the other, and depending upon the weapon, it had different, and the travel of that weapon and how it's modeled, it would have it would vary in terms of volume and attack and decay. And so it's really a fun project, and it's a riff on Paul Virilio. You know, he wrote 1970s, he wrote that book Speed and Politics, and his premise in that book is history moves at the sound history moves at the speed of its weapon systems. And that premise is based on the idea of civilizations rationalize velocity at the speed that's equal to the speed of their weapon systems. So what we wanted to look at was the Pueblo Revolt was more than just a conflict between people. It was a conflict between civilizations, and it was a conflict in of velocity, the way we rationalize velocity, the way we build our bureaucratic systems around velocity, the way we rationalize time, temporal spatial relationships. Very important way, you know, issues in terms of configuring reality. Very, very different worldviews and conceptions of time and space and violence and individual accountability for that violence and for that speed and for those spatial temporal relationships. So it was just a way to rip on that, to use a famous French theorist and kind of just turn his work sideways or turn it upside down and be able to play with that. It's a real fun piece to create.
Do you want to finish these?
Oh, yeah. Then the third piece we did was, it's my second home, but I have a very spiritual connection with this place. Now, this was a two-channel video installation that was essentially a surveillance piece. We shot with big lenses from anywhere from a quarter mile to a half mile away from our subject matter, and did a surveillance of Santa Fe, of all of the second homes, because Santa Fe is a second home place. You go there in the summer and there's like 70,000 people going there that live there. You go in the winter time, it's like 35,000, 40,000. You know, it's pretty empty. It was a way of exploring that. And then we wanted to take, we worked with actors, and we wanted to take sort of this unconscious narrative of Santa Fe, the people who live in the second homes that no one really sees, and give them a stage. Place them in the woods in a contested space where state land, tribal land, federal land sort of intersect, and have them act out their interpretation, their relationship to the land. So you have this really interesting psychosocial narrative going on the landscape, and then you have this really hyper-paranoid, you know, surveillance of the land and the neighborhoods of the second homers of Santa Fe.
So, like, I'll say it. Like, in two of, there's, in a couple of scenes in this piece, one is, we had a group of people who kind of looked like they were an Outward Bound or kind of this kind of self-help or type of group, and we gave them this, this task of doing an acting exercise. It's kind of like a sense memory empathy exercise. It's very just common in acting, and this lady who was leading it was really good, and we had a guy just completely break down, and he was going through a hard time apparently, and just really
really involved, you know, and it was really kind of amazing how lost in this piece that, you know, some of our actors got and the commitment to it. The other thing was is this this image of the second homes. We basically, you know, we're surveilling all these different homes and stuff, and looking at the footage afterwards, and noticed this argument is going on in one of these condos here. There are lovers that were having an argument. Eventually, they close the blinds, move on, you know, and things like that. But it's a two-channel piece with a kind of a droning soundtrack. And it's, again, it's a part of a larger, it's a suite of three. It's called the Dream, it wasn't the Dream of Golden Cities. So this was kind of the contemporary, the very modern or postmodern version of Santa Fe that we want to represent here. This is one of my favorite pieces of Postcommodity. We both feel that this piece does not get enough love and attention in our practice. And I just feel that the harmonics of suburban dreams. In the Southwest and in places, you know, like Phoenix, especially, but in Dallas, in certain neighborhoods in Oklahoma, there, if you in the summertime, if you're sitting in the backyard and you're have a pool, or your neighbors have a pool, or if you're in an affluent neighborhood, you'll hear the pool pumps cycling on and off, and it becomes this kind of beautiful minimalist composition. And that was truly the inspiration for this piece, was thinking about, you know, the, kind of the, not just water scarcity, but how our large-scale infrastructural projects have altered the landscape to, in a sense, to where it's unrecognizable to where it was before, creating scarcity, creating, you know, conflicts, you know, need, you know, things like what Chinatown is about, you know, that you know, this idea that where does your water come from? And it's also very, it's a noise piece. First of all, you know, this was, one thing about doing our Postcommodity is that sometimes we're, you know, you're taught, we bring in, we're brought in, we don't create something and send it. We go somewhere and we have to install it within a number of days. Well, this is very stressful because there are how many gallons, which equals so many tons of water. So it's like driving in a couple of, you know, 2-ton trucks in there in this pristine, beautiful gallery that is above a theater that is a part of a larger arts and cultural space. It's a school. It's just this wonderful little place in Lawrence, Kansas. So when we're making this, everybody's having this nightmare of these gallons and gallons and tons of water just coming down and flooding this theater below.
Like board members would show up.
Yeah, it's kind of like
see how things are going.
It's kind of like The Shining with the blood coming out of the elevators. That's I think everybody was envisioning that. But we have this kind of array of irrational. They look like also. Audio tones, square waves, triangles, things like that. We've created a system that kind of mimics the feedback, this flow is. There's two pool pumps. Connected to the two pool pumps are two very small guitar amplifiers. They use piezo microphones to pick up the vibrations of the pumps. And we're really just trying to accentuate the differences in the cycles of the pumps that are happening to create harmonic difference tones in the space. So that's what you're hearing when you're out at night. You're hearing one cycle on, one cycle off. And Kade earlier referred to it as, in another talk, to similar to the work of Eleonora Deeg, major, you know, contemporary drum composers, in the sense that very minimal, very subtle work that is, you know, really very about immersing yourself in the environment, getting lost in the sound. I'll stop.
You go into that space, you close your eyes, you lay down on your back, and you can get totally lost. I mean, it's just a beautiful drum. It just draws you in. it's quite an immersive environment. It looks like a sculptural environment, sculptural installation environment, very much an immersive installation environment. And wherever you move physically in the space, you'll get a different nuance of that, of those different tones. And you'll see them interacting, you'll hear them and feel them interacting with the architecture differently wherever you position yourself. It's a very dynamic, interactive piece. But one thing that it demonstrates is an unintended consequence, I think, of our art practice, is regardless of what kind of work we tried, set out to produce, it seems like at the end of the day, it always ends up emerging as an instrument, as a totally functioning instrument. For instance, this can be played by using the valves of each of the pumping systems. There's one pumping system on the left, there's one pumping system on the right. So if you play with the valves, you can get new nuances, new difference tones, things like that. So it's really just a large analog synthesizer, if you can think about that.
And something else that really kind of seems to be, you know, I see a connection to this work and say, Do You Remember When? In a sense where, going back to Mel Chin, where you have this crazy idea that nobody will let you do and you propose it and you think they're going to say no and then you've got to do it. Well, it wasn't necessarily like cutting a hole out of the floor. It was letting them put tons and tons of water in this space. Some of the worries were obviously the theater underneath, but they were also worried about us just staining the ground below it. Thankfully, we still have a really good relationship with Lawrence Arts Center. We've done other works there recently. We did not ruin their floor. But we did have a plumber assistant on this, and so it was really fun all night working, fixing leaks, because we just were running around this space and there would be a leak here, but there were no leaks when it opened.
And no water marks on the floor, nothing. So we were really fortunate to hold up our end of the bargain. But that's one thing we have learned throughout our art practice, is the importance of smaller art institutions for supporting experimentation. Their commitment to this project was really fantastic. We had a residency at the Santa Fe Art Institute. They provided us with the budget to develop this piece during our residency with all the gear, all the equipment, water, everything, just so that we could make sure that it would function properly before we install it in their space. And that's a very small institution. Resources are scared in the art world, but that's where art comes from. It's really a way of taking our hats off and acknowledging the important role that places like CentralTrak play, or Lawrence Arts Center, and there's so many of them in the US and Canada and throughout Europe, that's what drives art production, creativity, and inspires us all. So, another reason why we wanted to show this piece. This is the piece that has been on view for the last month here at CentralTrak. It's Gallup Motel Butchering. This piece was developed in 2011. It was commissioned for an exhibition called Here that was organized and curated by the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts Museum, which in the past has been a very conservative space, very focused on the tradition of painting, the tradition of sculpture, the formalist traditions of both of those mediums. Well, about 10 years ago, they acquired a building across the street from their what has always been their museum and their school campus, and they created a contemporary space. And since that point, they have been committed to showing contemporary art and curating shows, not just having traveling shows to go through, but really be actively involved in the discourse and developing discourse. And the curatorial premise of that exhibition was to look beyond the power centers of the art world and look at what the artists are creating in the periphery. So there were about 10 communities or 7 communities or so in the U.S. that they were looking at. Phoenix was one of them. Postcommodity came out of Phoenix in many ways and has been supported by the Phoenix art community throughout our development even to now. So we were chosen by a curator that was focusing on Phoenix, and so we produced this piece, and it's, as you know, it's just the butchering of sheep. It's a really simple act. It's something that Navajos do every day, you know. Usually it's outdoors though, you know, and usually it's happening for a birthday or a graduation or a ceremony or a family reunion or, you know, whatever you can think of. And in this case, we took something that happens all of the time into a place, a physical location, that where this sort of thing rarely happens, you know. And the piece is all about looking at the power of context, and the power of context and imagination, the power of context and perception, and the power of context in terms of takeaway meaning of the individual's audiences. And does everybody know another French theorist? We like to fuck around with French theorists a little bit. From spaces to non-places, or from places to non-places. He wrote about this idea of non-place, of super modernity, and this idea that you know, these non-places are places of commerce, places of trade, places that are defined by globalism. And what essentially a motel is or could be related to, you know, for a fee, you sleep, wake up, you leave. It's a transitional space. It's a space of transitional commerce. Much like an airport. And so it was a really good signifier for this idea. So what Ajay argues very anthropologically is that the authenticity of culture is being lost and supplanted by the rise of non-places. So, and that can be signified when you do something that is more culturally traditional in one of these non-places. So he wrote a book about this and went through a lot of different examples. So we thought we'd create our own example, and that was a motel sheep butchering. So we went into a motel and videotaped the butchering of sheep by a former Miss Navajo runner-up, which is important to note. And this was her first time butchering a sheep. There's like 2 years when the Miss Navajo pageant didn't include sheep butchering, and her year was one of them. 1958 was the other. I think she was like 1986 or something like that. So she was runner-up, didn't have to butcher a sheep, never butchered a sheep in her whole life. So really what you're seeing is a very intimate experience, an experience where she's exposing herself as a woman, and her role as a woman within her tribe, within her culture, because women are the sheep butcherers. And it's a very, very important experience, for coming of age experience for Navajo women. So she did this on camera in the hotel room. She's willing to expose herself and take a risk, as we were able to expose ourselves as artists and take a risk. Because there's a lot at stake when you go in with production crew to shoot something like this in a motel, because all that money you're investing in the project could be thrown out the window if the managers of the hotel find out what you're doing and shut you down, and maybe the police arrive and so forth. But what happened was she was able to, for the first time in her life, successfully butcher the sheep. It was awkward, you know, as the space was awkward. And she was nervous, as that space creates nervous energy. So her experience really drove home the awkwardness of taking something
of cultural significance out of its intended context, placing a commercial context, what you get is something that looks incredibly violent. You know, for non-Indian people, when they look at this piece, typically the reaction is, this is incredibly violent and brutal. Why is that? Well, it's because it's not taking place in its intended context. You know, there's so many things that can be that way. So for Indian people, an important part of our cultural self-determination is to not just maintain our practices, but maintain the context of our practices. Because the context is what maintains the meaning of our practice. So it was a nice piece to produce, and I think it's one of our more iconic works, and it's one of my favorite video, you know, installations that we produce for sure.
Kind of, I think something that Kid didn't mention is this really the origins of this piece. And the first time I heard it was actually in Santa Fe at Indian Market. Was at in a hotel, you know, drinking with some people. And this idea, you know, somebody was telling a story about going to Phoenix for a graduation or something or party, and wanting to have a feed, you know, to have a celebration. And Navajo's driving off into, you know, an hour outside of town, buying a sheep, bringing it back, and a grandmother butchering it. And so it was like an urban myth. Like, nobody said, oh, this was my grandma or whoever did this, but this was something that people were talking about, you know, and it was like this, it was just like a rural myth or an Indian myth that we really kind of wanted to explore. It was just, in living in any country, there's a lot of crazy stories, and it's really fun and interesting. People are really funny. These really absurd things happen, and that was really... really where this idea originated from, was just in a myth, just a story that somebody told one night at a party.
So you don't get a sensationalized take, it's just cinema verde style, you know, it is what happened. And the event was part of a impromptu family reunion, because when my wife's family found out what we were doing, they all showed up to eat it. You know, so we had about 20 Navajos in the parking lot ready to eat dinner, and it was fantastic.
Why did you choose not to create that?
What's that?
Because
it's just a butchering. That, you know, that's, people eat at hotels, but people don't butcher. So we were really trying to look at that issue of context and just keep a nice, tight, focused piece. I think that was our goal. Because we didn't show the people shooting the thing either, the brutality, you know, the challenge of, you know, trying to work in a really confined space, and the awkwardness of it. We didn't show it either. Or we didn't include the smells. You know, there's a lot of things that didn't get included.
I have one question about that. So, do you think that if this is going to be the repeated, for instance, the hotel butchering becomes common, do you think that it will be authentic?
Say the last...
Let's say that, you know, this is very unusual because it's not authentic, it's out of space, out of context. But let's assume that it's unaccepted, and then we start to see that on butchering sheep in the hotel bathroom is actually common practice. Do you think that it will be authentic at one point?
It could. You know, human behavior is largely pragmatic. And
so is it new? That's why it's shocking to us?
It's what's shocking is the context, more than anything. I don't know if it's the newness.
But why is it shocking to us? I mean, if we take the butchering the sheep is the shocking part, regardless of where it's done, even though we know that it's done in culture. Why is it shocking in the bathroom?
Well, the thing that we would look at is, again, the context. Because if this same Navajo woman was doing it in her backyard on the reservation, it would be on National Geographic. By shifting that traditional animal husbandry activity into a commercial space, a space where that sort of activity is not accepted or not legal, not done regularly, it changes the act itself to something. But I don't know how else to answer that question other than, you know.
I assume there are some other rituals associated with before and after the sacrifice, right? Were they also taking place during this act?
We didn't film any of that. But for sure, you know, a prayer, making sure the animal's facing east, or, you know, when you slit its throat, things like that. There's a lot going on.
But for rural people, this would not be a very shocking image. You know, for somebody who grew up in the country, it's, and so, you know, a lot of questions have been asked about, you know, kind of the place where you intend to exhibit it and what it is and what we're doing. And I mean, we just know that we're all very much hidden from the industrialization of our food process. If people had to actually kill and butcher the animals that they had to eat, we'd probably have a lot of vegetarians and vegans, you know. It's very offensive by people who eat meat, cook meat regularly. But I think it is really, it is about these things. It's taking it out of context, but it's also what we've become accustomed to, and it's kind of a privilege, you know.
And those are kind of complicated discourses or narratives that we like to insert ourselves into and examine and further complicate through our work. You know, just stretch a full meaning, you know, and provide an immersive environment for audiences to step into these problematic situations and formulate, you know, their own ideas and responses, and, you know, formulate a responsive way of moving forward, you know, from there.
One thing too, just real quick, the sound, I think, should be, you know, acknowledged. And basically, you have the sound of Indian women cooking in a kitchen for a completely different event. And we just really wanted to stay away from, you know, the tropes of strings or drones. We wanted to be able to find a way to
really hear the music.
Yeah, to kind of, something non-musical, something that, you know, just created, it actually creates more of an eerie sense than, say, you know, strings or synths or whatever, you know, this kind of banging and sharpening and things like that. But you're not hearing this going on, you're hearing another meal. You're hearing mundane tasks, cooking, cleaning. This is our latest piece that's been realized. It's called, there are two pieces.
Lights on the screen so you can't see the image.
Two pieces working together. It's called cross-pollination. It's at the Scottsdale Museum of Contemporary Native Arts, or Contemporary Art. And in it, well, it's closed, that's why it looks like. Oh, that's right. It's red there. But it's just the color balances off. So this is a reproduction of a working adult peep show that's located in Albuquerque, New Mexico. The spectator walks in, sees basically this kind of facsimile or this copy of a peep show in New Mexico. You walk in, you have a coin, you put the coin in, the blind raises up, and the viewer is confronted with an image of beauty of nature. So you have these layers and layers of plants, different types of ferns, all things, but also there are a number of butterflies in this space. So really the analogy or what we're kind of comparing nature to this fetishization of the woman's body and this this possibility in the future of this fetishization of, you know, nature. And then this already exists today in golf courses, landscape, things like that. But in the context with the other piece, really creates these issues of desire. Also, the other piece is basically very similar to the ambush in the sense that it's an IED model. So you go from this space where you're surrounded by videos, and you'll set off a trigger, and you'll have shards of sound and bass, and shards of Phil Collins, Metallica come at you, and shaped like a bomb, and then have the opportunity to go in and look at a peep show full of plants and butterflies.
And we tried to, I mean, we created the. We recreated the peep show called Adults in South Albuquerque, South Valley, to scale, and as much as we could. You know, when you're poking your nose around a peep show, you can end up in jail. So we were kicked out of the place and told not to ever come back. You know, because we were wondering what mechanisms are you using to make the window go up, you know, like how big is this space, can I measure it, can I take photos, you know, things like that. So we had to recreate from memory, and did, and it's a real surreal space. It has razor wire at the top so people don't climb over the booths to get at the ladies, and the smell, it literally smelled like 20 years of dudes jacking off in there, and so it was really brutal. So we recreated the smells, you know, with squirting pine salt and bleach into the corners of the space, and using a elk scent, you know, like for bow hunting, you know. We use that, yeah, it's like a elk scent that smells a lot like 20 years of dudes jerking off into a space. It's that brutal. So we just, it comes in a roll-on or a spray. We took the roll-on, and it's clear, you know, non-staining, you know, if you want to wear it, you know, it won't stain your clothes. But we just rubbed that on, and it really had a powerful impact. Because people had that experience, like, holy shit, I'm in the middle of a contemporary art museum, you know, this space of power and prestige for the affluent, and here I am confronted or participating in, you know, a peep show. So it was a way of looking at power structures, you know, in the art world, in these gallery spaces, and being able to riff on that as well. Yes?
Were you consciously thinking of a tunnel name of the piece by Duchamp, where you look through the gate at the with actually a pigskin, but it was like a woman who looks sort of hard and blind.
There's so many pieces that riff like that, you know, but no, I don't think so.
I'm just curious. I mean, it's basically a peep show thing. It's kind of archived with that. I mean, he did it before he was sort of.
Yeah.
It's the Philadelphia Museum of Art. Permanently.
The irony of this is that we can't go back to Adults, but now we can open our own peep show.
We have all the gear. There's the mechanisms to operate this. The only place in North America that sells them is a place called Videotel. And they have the live pornography market cornered. And they do an excellent job of customer service. But their technology is flawed inherently. It's very buggy, and you know, it took a lot of work to get that thing to work consistently as it should.
The other thing was too is that you're in a museum space here in Scottsdale, and everybody was using the Purell antibacterial soap after they would leave. I thought that somebody was taking and just ripping off a piece of paper every time and throwing it on the floor. I thought somebody in the collective was doing it to make it look like it was being used, but every time I'd see somebody come out, they would curl their hands, and it's like, it's all good, man, you know? It's that dirty.
In the picture that we're looking at, you can see the color of the booth. You can see the light coming in. You can see the Kleenex box right here. There's a trash can right beneath it. There's a coin slot. You know, it's very much, as authentic.
Did you have a sense that explained that it was beach or did you read well enough that you didn't need that?
There was a didactic panel that really, explained that,
how museums are.
Yeah, it's sort of too bad.
They have a didactic panel for everything. Someone hiccups in the gallery space, there's a curator with a didactic panel trying to contextualize that hiccup.
Well, I saw something where someone curated like some graffiti on a wall, in that same way. You could see the beginning was an angst, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, it's a really fun piece, and we're really happy that institutions get behind ideas like that. Scottsdale Museum of Contemporary Art is not a top-tier museum. It's not the Whitney, it's not MoMA, it's not LACMA, it's not LA MoCA. It has a history of commissioning work. About every couple years, they'll stick their necks out and commission new work and support that new work and treat your installation time as an artist residency time. And that's what they did. It was fantastic. It's just, again, important to acknowledge the support of the smaller institutions out there. Very, very important for art production. This is the piece that we're working on right now. It's called The Repellent Fence. It's a social collaborative project among individuals, communities, institutional organizations, publics, and sovereigns that's located adjacent to the traditional homelands of the Tonawatam people. Out at 2 miles outside west of the cities of Agua Prieta, Sonora, Mexico, and Douglas, Arizona, U.S. And the space itself is one of the most contested spaces in the hemisphere. You have significant cartel activity and violence and trafficking of humans and drugs, weapons. And then you have all sorts of other organized crime activities that are happening in the area. A lot of people think cartels are only involved in human trafficking and smuggling of weapons and drugs, but they're involved in things like real estate development. They're involved in building public schools. They're involved in labor disputes. They're involved in trash management and resource management, in mining, in any kind of economy you can think of that exists in the Southwest. They have significant stakes in it, and they're laundering money through those facets of the economy. And in the borderlands, there's 0 degrees of separation from the cartels to the citizens. So it's a very charged, emotional, and paranoid place. Heavily fortified, heavily militarized. And within the Arizona border alone, you have, on any given day, between 50,000 and 70,000 troops that are patrolling that border and the southern regions of Arizona. So at once it's a militarized occupation, and on the other side of the coin, it's what you might call subsidized employment, because the Border Patrol is the largest employer of the borderlands region. More than any mining company, more than any corporation, more than Walmart, more than any university, more than any Fortune 500 company, the largest employer is Border Patrol. The second largest employer would be the cartels. So, really interesting dynamic that you get down there. And the This piece started out wanting to do it in the Tohono-O'odham Reservation because the Tohono-O'odham is a tribe that is divided by the border on the west side of Arizona. I mean, literally 60% of the tribe is in the U.S., 40% in Mexico. And, you know, there have been a lot of articles, reports written about the Tohono-O'odham experience. We thought it was a great metaphor for the hemisphere. This idea of Indian people being divided from each other, being divided from their land, their communities, their culture, all because of a foreign geopolitical demarcation is very, very problematic. We were really interested in exploring that idea. And we wanted to locate this piece there. When we talked to the tribe, it wasn't possible. Yeah, there's no First Amendment rights on tribal lands. The tribal government maniacally controls all facets of political and social discourse. So we were not allowed to do that. Even though there were individual tribal members that loved the idea, we continue to meet tribal members that love the idea, but still, there is a strong desire for the government, the tribal government, to control the discourse around border issues. And that's for good reason. Tribal people, we don't believe in individual liberty like, you know, the mainstream of America or the West does, you know. Being a tribal person is about knowing your role in a tribal society, culturally and socially. So it's a little bit different. We definitely understand that and acknowledge that and appreciate it. Ceremonial environments aren't environments for individual liberties. They're environments for shared sacrifice and subverting the ego for the betterment of the whole, you know? So our worldview is shaped that way, but it led to an effort, like, okay, we wanted to do this idea there and couldn't. So we had to rethink the piece, and we had to rethink, well, is it the feasibility of the piece, and so on and so forth.
And this is not the piece.
Yeah.
What you see here on the bottom left going out, you know, kind of the bottom third of the image is, it's not the larger part of the wall that's been built along the border. It's a smaller barrier. It's more of a car barrier that look like crosses to go along. So this was more of a marketing piece, more of a proof of concept piece. This, the repellent fence, just to kind of go back and give you a little bit of more context, is this was the original idea that Postcommodity came together around. In 2006 and 2007, this national dialogue about immigration, this immigration crisis, was really starting to, you know, begin its fever pitch. And we wanted to take it, the discussion, we wanted to resituate the discussion, not in this binational U.S.-Mexico binary. We wanted to place it within a larger context of American Indian, or just a larger context, to where things that actually might affect me as an American Indian, as somebody who might have medicine across that border, is no longer to gather that medicine for ceremonies. We wanted to really acknowledge that, you know, there's a larger narrative that exists, and take it out of the U.S.-Mexico border dichotomy. But again, it's a 2 mile long. Those scare-eye balloons, I think it will take 30 of them. I think that's how many we're ordering now. And it will be a 2 mile long fence that bisects another fence. So what you're seeing here, this black line, will be a row of scare-eye balloons. And these scare-eye balloons are what people use. I guess we spend a lot of time around the pool or something in the backyard. But so, like, you know, people will use these in their backyards to scare off birds, but they don't work. And so you put this in your yard for 3 days, and then, you know, day five, there's bird crap all over it. And we thought that it was a really great monument to the futility of the fence in general, because that's, you know, somebody's, there are so many resources to get above the fence, to get to below the fence, to go around the fence. really, it seems to me that the fence really seems to cause most harm in the ecology of animals, of deer, you know, and animals that are trying to cross it. But it really doesn't stop humans.
And what you can't see because the projectors aren't calibrated, so you're just seeing black and yellow. But these balloons are, you know, red. This should be red. And inside is black and it's white. The main balloon field of the color of the balloon is yellow. Those are really core medicine colors for Indian people, this hemisphere. And that iconography that you see there is known as the open eye. That's an iconography used by Indian people, indigenous people from Central America all the way up into Canada. It's really significant to people from Central America to the Southeast tribes, Southwest tribes. It demonstrates the interconnectedness of the hemisphere. That long before the border was erected, before Mexico existed, before the U.S. existed, thousands of years of trade has happened among indigenous people, cultural exchanges that have proliferated this iconography from south to north. So while this piece, we started with this idea of futility, a monument of futility. Just like any piece, when you start working with it, you go from drawing board to actually working with material and developing proofs of concepts and really getting beyond that point of no return in your piece where you've invested so much time into it, there's no turning back. No matter what happens, you're gonna do it. And that's when meaning really reveals itself to you, right? When your preconceptions become meaningless and the piece declares its own meaning and finds its own context through that process, you know? And so this process of trying to find a location for this piece, we started discovering what it meant. So we essentially went from Tonal Otham Nation and just worked our way east till we found a town that would be interested in hosting it and working with us on it. And we all almost made it all the way to New Mexico. And Douglas, as you can see, is, you know, the Mexico border right here. Douglas is here. That's like less than, you know, 40-minute drive. So almost to the New Mexico border. And Agua Prieta and Douglas, two border cities, sister cities. Their cities in the 70s were indistinguishable from each other. The families lived on both sides without any problem. You didn't need a driver's license or a passport to walk across the border. You just walked across the border. There was no wall. You didn't have to go through a checkpoint. You just walked across the border wherever you wanted in town. There was no demarcation of Douglas, Arizona, and Agua Prieta, you know, Sonora, Mexico. It was just a town. And now there's a 20-foot wall that goes right through town. And now you have people that have families on both sides that they just don't take their children to see their relatives. And, you know, if you're in Douglas, they just don't take their children to go see their relatives in Agua Prieta and vice versa. Because of the violence, because of the harassment of crossing the border, because of all sorts of, you know, issues between those two issues. What these cities are really trying to rediscover and is this idea of interconnectedness, this idea of returning to the way of life before the war on drugs, in the 70s, of creating binational dialogue, binational memory, binational experience. You know, that's what they're after. So when they looked at our piece and our idea, what they found in our piece was not a monument of futility. They looked at it because they saw this. They said, that looks like a suture to us. This looks like a suture reconnecting, you know, two bodies of land that have been divided, two nations have been divided, families and cultures. you know, communities. So they saw this as a metaphorical suture. So all of a sudden, a piece that was once thought of was to be this monument to futility and mocking the border, whatever, you know, suddenly became this monument to interconnectedness, to demonstrating interconnectedness. It became something that celebrated the indigeneity of the people who are the migrants. They're indigenous people coming from small tribal communities that are no longer sustainable because of NAFTA, because of trade policy, because it's cheaper to buy biogenetically engineered corn that is grown by multinational corporations in Canada than it is to buy corn that used to be grown in a field across the street from where they lived, which is now sitting dormant because of the corn prices. Those communities are not sustainable, so they're doing what they do. They work. They know farming. That's their culture. That's where they came from. So they come up north until they get a job farming. Send their money back, whatever it is. But that is what this piece now became. You know, as a social practice piece, it became a co-intentional narrative, a co-intentional metaphor through that community engagement process. We had this thing, we didn't know what it was, and it suddenly had meaning, cultural meaning, community meaning. You know, yes.
So what was the original idea of going perpendicular versus parallel?
Well, you don't want to create a parallel thing, you know, to create the fence parallel to the fence. It wouldn't.
I mean, I just see this, they're kind of like scarecrows, and you put it along the fence. I mean, I would have been adding something parallel. So why didn't you have a straight shot straight up through?
Now, this is the current version. This is what we're going to be installing. October 9th through it'll be up October 9th through the 12th. That's a current version. So, but this is to reach across the border.
It's always been important that it's bi-national.
Yeah.
It's always been important that it connects the United States and the Mexican side.
Okay, so from the very start of
this? Yeah, from the very beginning.
Yeah. And from the very beginning, it's been thought of as a land art piece.
So,
it'll be up 4 days.
4 days.
It's a ceremony.
And now the community has really, you know, they've just kind of used it as a jumping off point. Other artists in the area that will be doing actions or events around it. And if you go back to this, one of the first image, this is on it's not Douglas Ranch. It's a ranch.
Glen
Ranch. You put people in danger, you know, immediately whenever you did this. Whenever this was flown, there was chatter from the drug cartels and their communication system.
They had a communications hub right up here.
They were wondering about the nature of it. They didn't know if it was a new surveillance balloon or something because there was drones flying in the area. But, you know, we were talking and researching it with all these landowners. And they were like, you know, we think what you're doing is great. The problem is they already don't like us, and they're going to kill one of my workers if you do it on our land. And so you, not to be overly dramatic, but it's really, truly, you know, what people were saying to us. And so not to be flippant, you know, or anything about that. I mean, that's those are real lives. We're not, that's really irresponsible to parachute in, get people killed, you know, things like that. We don't want to do that. But once this, you know, I was compared to, you know, all these pieces, you know, we have drawings or ideas, and then they become their own thing. But once the community, once we have these roundtable discussions, you know, we envision this idea of creating, this is a militarized zone. You know, we envision creating this zone of safety. Well, it wasn't really possible until we had basically the will of the community behind it.
Typically, there are projects, the borderlands, or guerrilla activities using informal networks. So we use a combination of formal and informal networks to achieve this piece. And it's the only way to do it to ensure the security of the audience when they go down.
So there'll be this art walk there for the first time. It'll be the first binational art walk. that has an event score where people will be crossing the border continually for 12 hours. I think there's also a huge fire. You know, and a lot of times, you know, it's like, you know, we worry about being co-opted, especially when you're doing like, whatever, that's like, you know, first year of art school, you know, I don't want to be co-opted, but it's a real reality, right? And, being co-opted by the Border Patrol or whatever, but the reality of it is that we've kind of, you know, just found collaborative partners in the community, and it really made it possible. This is something that for many, many years, like the first idea for this is in 2006, 2007, it's 2015 now. We've imagined all these scenarios, situations, what happened, something we could not even imagine, but it made it happen, or it made the possibility of it happening, we're moving forward. And it's just much more interesting than you know, the situation we'd envisioned.
And that is October 9th through the 12th. We invite you all to come down with us. There's a hotel called Hotel Gadsden. We're reserving a block of 150 rooms. So please get your reservations made as soon as possible, because they're going really, really quick. And it'll be an exciting time, be a really fun place. Site Santa Fe is organizing a group to travel from Santa Fe, the Arizona State University Art Museum, as part of the Desert Initiative, is organizing a group to travel from the Phoenix area down. So we're hoping to bring about 150 people to 300 people down by bus to get a critical mass of people. But I think since, you know, Texas is such an important state in the context of borderlands, it'd be nice to get some Texans down there. It'd be really, it'd mean a lot to us.
How is the border going to work during that event? Like, is it going to be where you still have a passport card?
Oh, yeah.
You need a passport.
Yeah, you don't need a U.S. passport to get to Mexico, but you need one to come back. And let me show you let's see here. You can, this is a highway, Highway 2. This is the border, the yellow line. Now from the city, Agua Prieta is here, Douglas is up there. You can hop on the 2 and drive right to it. Park your car. We have a land use agreement with the landowner who owns this land on both sides of the border. So you can park there. It's probably the best place to view the piece is on the Mexico side. And then on the US side, it's right adjacent to the Border Patrol headquarters, which you can see right above that black line. And that pathway is going to be, if that's not going to be the new port of entry, it's going to be within a half mile of that line to the west. That's why Border Patrol is really excited to work with us, because they can create a positive narrative around the piece for the development of the new port of entry. So, yeah, it's will be viewable, but you will have to cross the border either by foot or by car. But that port of entry is, the wait is like 5 minutes. It's so easy to get across there. It's a very economically depressed area. It used to be a mining community, copper mining. So they have they had a copper smelter in Douglas that employed, you know, most of the people. That went out in the 90s, but you can see the scar from it. These are two mountains created from the remnants of the copper smelting process. And so that's what you see in Agua Prieta is a place where there's maquiladoras, and Douglas is so depressed that U.S. workers are crossing the border to work for $2.50 an hour in the maquiladoras. So, really interesting place, yeah. But please come out and join us. And thank you for having us and allowing us to speak. Really enjoyed our time.
If you have any questions too.
Yeah.